And, you know, that's a topic that's extremely rich and extremely important and relevant. And brainstorming, you know, the qualities and characteristics that are integral for a Muslim to have, I came up with a lot of qualities. There's a lot. The obvious and the not so obvious. You know, qualities that we speak about constantly in our khutab and our classes. Things like patience, things like forbearance, things like humility. All of these are grand qualities and important qualities that are qualities of a Muslim. And then there are qualities just as important that are spoken of less often. Qualities like ambition. And qualities like optimism. And this is eventually the quality that I thought was important to speak about. And that is the quality of positive thinking. Alright, and for some people, for those who may know me, I don't think there's anyone, alhamdulillah, amongst the brothers that know me well. But if you did know me well, you'd be scratching your head thinking, you know, out of all people to speak about optimism, Salah has decided to speak about optimism. And the reason that scratched their head is because they know me to be somewhat pessimistic. Right, I seem to incline more towards pessimism rather than optimism. And while that's not completely true, there is some truth to it. Right, there is some truth to it. And that's because there are people who seem to incline more towards pessimism naturally. That's the way they've developed themselves. And there are those, mashallah, who are more jolly, right? They're always smiling, they're always happy, they're always optimistic, they're always thinking positive. But for those of us who are inclined towards pessimism, it's important to know that our character is not set in stone. Right? If we have faults and defects, there is always room to change. So if we do have a problem in our character or in our qualities, there's room for us to change and improve. And this quality of optimism is a quality that we find taught throughout the Quran and throughout the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I would go as far as to say that every single prophet that came with this quality of optimism. This quality of always thinking in a positive way. And from amongst those who were most optimistic is our Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. And you will find this type of attitude in the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam during all times of his life. Right, if you were to read through his seerah during the time of Mecca, during that time of turbulence in his life, where he was abused, where he was tortured, and his companions likewise, you would find optimism during that span of life. When he was starving, you would find optimism in the statements and in the actions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. No matter what the situation was, no matter what the matter was, hardships, difficulties, you find this type of attitude. And we often speak about, you know, the sunnah of the way we dress. Right? The sunnah of the beard, the sunnah of the hijab. And the importance of such sunan. And no doubt, such sunan are important. But just as important is the sunnah of attitude as well. Right, the sunnah in the way you think, and there is a sunnah to the way you think. Right, the way you think, not only to what occurs to you as an individual, but what occurs to the ummah as a whole. Now, this optimism stems from the husn of dhan that we have towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we think the best of Allah. We think only good of Allah. And if you only think good of Allah, that should create a positive outlook. And Allah Ta'ala, He mentions the story of Musa to us. You know the story of Musa alayhi salam, when he was chased out of Egypt with his followers, until he came to a dead end. You know, there was no further way to flee. There was no way to go. There was only an ocean in front of them. And so the followers of Musa, they remarked, قَالَ أَصْحَابُ مُوسَىٰ إِنَّا لَمُدْرَكُونَ. The people of Musa, they straight away went to the assumption that it's all over. Right, we have been followed and now we have been caught. However, what was the automatic response of Musa alayhi salam? Musa alayhi salam automatically, he responded, he said, كَلَّا إِنَّ مَعِيَ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِينَ. He said, no, absolutely not. Why? Because I have my Lord with me. I have Allah with me. And He will guide me. I have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have no reason to despair. I've got no reason to give up. Why? Because I'm a believer, I'm a Muslim. And as a believer and a Muslim, I rely on Allah. He is my protector. I have hope that He will come to save me. He is my sustainer. He is my creator. He is the one who is in charge of everything. He's in charge of all of my affairs. And we hear in the hadith that if this whole nation was to come together in order to harm you, they will not be able to harm you, except by the will of Allah. If all of this nation came together in order to benefit you, they will not be able to benefit you, except by the will of Allah. So everything is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the story of Ya'qub alayhi salam is also related to us. You know, Ya'qub and the trial of Ya'qub alayhi salam with his children, where firstly, he loses Yusuf. You know, his child, his most beloved child. He loses him and he's given a story that Yusuf has been eaten up. And then on top of this calamity, he loses his second child. Right, he loses Binyamin, another beloved child. And, you know, for the normal person on the street, this would be enough to give up. This would be enough to despair. Right? This would be enough for them to go into an alcoholic state, to take on drugs. But what was the response of Ya'qub alayhi salam? And in these stories are lessons for us. Right? What did Ya'qub tell his children when they went forth to Egypt? اذهبوا اذهبوا فتحسسوا من يوسف وأخيه ولا تيأسوا من روح الله ولا تيأسوا من روح الله إنه لا ييأس من روح الله إلا القوم الكافرون. He still had hope that Yusuf is still alive. Binyamin is still alive. So he told his children, go forth to Egypt and don't forget to look for Yusuf alayhi salam. Don't forget to look for him. And he tells them, don't give up and don't despair. Why should they not despair? Whoever has children, please, if you can settle them down, will make my task a lot easier, inshallah. He told them, don't despair. Why should you not despair? Because the only one who truly despairs, the only one who truly gives up, are the disbelievers. Are the disbelievers. And that's why we're constantly cautioned in the Quran not to despair, not to give up hope. Because that's a quality not of a Muslim, it's a quality of a disbeliever. It's a quality of a hypocrite. Right? The Muslim is not like this. And that's why we find even in our Sharia that bad omens and bad luck does not exist. Right? The unlucky number 13. You know, don't go to room 13. Stay at home during Friday the 13th. If you're on a plane, you get the seat number 13, make sure you change it. It's bad luck. As Muslims, we don't believe in that. Or bad omens, right? You walk under a ladder or you see a black cat or I don't know what other omens they have out there. We don't have bad omens in Islam, but at the same time, there is such a thing as good omens, if that makes sense. Right, something that's called tafa'ul. Right, we do have that concept in Islam. That if you hear, you know, someone's traveling, you tell him, Ya Salim. You know, you give him a name like Ya Salim. Ya Salim literally means, you know, someone who's safe. So it's a type of good, maybe that person's name is Salim, and you say, inshallah, you remain Salim. It's a good sign. You remain safe. We have that in Islam. But as for bad omens, bad luck, that's something that's non-existent. In the battle of Ahzab, and this battle was a battle that separated the hypocrites from the true believers. And in this battle, you find the separation in attitude. And this is what I want to speak about very briefly. That separation in attitude. Right, the battle of Ahzab, when 10,000 strong from the Confederates, not only Quraysh, but its allies as well, came together in order to destroy and wipe Islam from the face of the earth. Right, 10,000 strong, well equipped, came to destroy the Muslims. The Muslims were in a weak state. And when they came, the believers remarked. Alright, the believers remarked and they said, Allah Ta'ala speaks and He says, وَلَمَّا رَأَى الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابِ قَالُوا هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. That when the believers saw the Ahzab, they saw them with their eyes. Now you can imagine the state, you know, you're seeing an enemy that's well equipped, you're outnumbered. You know, that's cause to lose hope. That's cause to say, Wallah, we're destroyed today. We've got no hope today. But what did they say? No. They said, this is the promise of Allah and His Messenger. And the promise of Allah and His Messenger is true. Right? Allah has promised us victory. And the Messenger of Allah has also promised us victory. And the promise of Allah is true. No matter the odds, no matter what we see in front of us, we have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We remain positive. And what was the response of the hypocrites? Allah ta'ala also relays their attitude. Their attitude, Allah ta'ala says, بَلْ ظَنَنْتُمْ أَلَّن يَنْقَلِبَ الرَّسُولُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِمْ أَبَدًا. That the hypocrites, they thought that Allah, that His Messenger and the believers will not return to their families ever again. That this spelt their demise, their destruction. This is what they thought, because this is what they saw. So they automatically thought the worst. This is whom? The hypocrites. وَزُيِّنَ ذَلِكَ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَظَنَنْتُمْ ظَنَّ السَّوْءِ وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا. And this was made, this was beautified and adorned in your hearts, and it found a place in your hearts. This type of attitude, this type of thought. وَظَنَنْتُمْ ظَنَّ السَّوْءِ. And you thought the worst of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You thought the worst of Allah. وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا. And in turn you became a pessimistic people. People who think the worst. Now think about what's happening around the world. Right? Not only your personal situation, but what's happening around the world and your attitude towards what's happening. You know, we often hear the problems that are happening, the lives that are being taken unjustly, the oppression that's occurring. And we feel sadness. And it's fine to feel sadness, and you should feel sadness, and it's part of Iman to feel sadness. If you don't feel sadness, then there is a problem in your Iman. When you hear 10,000 have been massacred, when you hear that the death toll in Syria has exceeded 100,000, for no reason except that they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that brings sadness to the heart. But we are not allowed to transform that sadness to pessimism. We are not allowed to transform that sadness to despair. You may be sad, but that sadness, right, that situation must be looked at as a whole. That despite the hardships, there's always good. Allah Ta'ala has a plan. And if you know that Allah Ta'ala has a plan, you remain hopeful. You remain hopeful. And while you might not understand the wisdom, you understand that Allah Ta'ala does not allow anything to occur except for a wisdom. And a wisdom may be expiation of sins. It may be to cleanse the ranks. It may be to take martyrs from amongst the people. Many wisdoms, whether you know those wisdoms or whether you do not know those wisdoms. However, as a believer, you have full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know that nothing afflicts the believer, except that it is good for him. Except that it is good for him. During this same battle of Ahzab, seeing the enemy coming in such great number, the Prophet ﷺ, when he was helping out dig the trench, just so you know the attitude, the mindset, he's got every reason to think that, wallahi, it's going to be tough coming out of this situation. Or it's going to be tough. But when the Prophet ﷺ was helping, and this shows you the, not even the mindset, but the character of the Prophet ﷺ, he was not above helping the companions. He was not above holding an axe and digging. Such was his leadership. And he was helping dig the trench. And when he was helping to dig the trench, he came across a rock, and he hit the rock, and a spark flew. And the Prophet ﷺ said, glad tidings to this ummah, I see them possessing the keys to Sham, conquering the Byzantine Empire. One of the greatest empires during that time. And he hit the rock once again, and a spark flew. And he said, by Allah, I see the ummah possessing the keys of Persia. The Persian Empire. The second greatest empire during that time. And a third spark flew. And he said, by Allah, I see this Muslim ummah possessing the keys to Yemen. The keys to Yemen. The Prophet ﷺ was giving him glad tidings during this situation, during this crisis. Right, and this was the attitude, this was the outlook of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. We are taught to remain positive even during times of defeat. Right, even during times of defeat, you're meant to remain positive. Right, you know, life is full of hardships, it's full of pain, it's full of suffering. And at the same time, it has its joys, you know. There are joys in life, and there is pain in life. And that's why they say there are two faces to this world. But the believer has one outlook, right? He has one attitude, and that's a positive attitude. That not only do you remain positive during times of victory, during times of success, but you also remain positive during times of defeat and during times of failure. Yes, even during times of failure. The Battle of Uhud, right? And you know how the Battle of Uhud ended. Initially, the Muslims had the upper hand. But at the end of the battle, they lost. And there were many that were martyred. And from amongst those who were martyred was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hamza. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Right? And you would think that this occurrence, this failure, if you want to call it a failure, however, it's not a failure. Because it was a lesson from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so often from defeat, there is a wisdom. And there are gifts. There are gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to us from these defeats. However, after this defeat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the companion. And he addresses his messenger alayhi salatu wassalam. وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. And listen to this verse very carefully. Allah Ta'ala says, and do not despair. وَلَا تَهِنُوا. And do not feel sad. Do not become overcome with sadness. And you are elevated and honored. But Allah didn't stop there. Right? This statement is conditional. You are elevated, you are honored, if indeed you are believers. If you are indeed believers, then look forward. Have trust in Allah. Have reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't give up. Don't let this failure, you know, stop you. And that's why Muslims do not dwell on failures. As a Muslim, you shouldn't dwell on your failures. If you fail in anything, you move on. You move on. Right? You don't dwell and wallow on missed opportunities. Right? This is the mentality that we need to adopt. You know, they say that the one who constantly looks at the problems, right, he's constantly pessimistic. Wallahi, I've got no hope in this business becoming successful. Wallahi, I've tried so hard to learn, but there's no hope for me. You know, I'm thick-headed. I've tried so much to please my wife, but and it seems like it's a dead end. Someone with that type of outlook is on the track to fail, and he is doomed to fail. And they say that the one who is optimistic, the one who has a positive outlook, he is on the way of success. He is the one that looks for solutions, he doesn't look at problems. And this is a shift in attitude again that we need to have. You know, so often we find Muslims, they're constantly complaining. And they've got a defeatist mentality. You know, well, there's no hope in the Ummah. Look at how many sinners out there there is. Well, I've tried to overcome my sins and I've got no hope. Look how weak the Muslim Ummah is. How do you expect them to defeat an enemy so strong? Look what's happening in Syria. And no one's coming to their aid. And they're constantly complaining and whinging. And no one's denying that, you know, some of these things are truths. But what we're speaking about and pointing at is the attitude, the mindset. And I think Brother Almir has got a similar topic. I hope what I'm speaking about, you know, complements his topic and doesn't, it's not stepping over what he's speaking about, inshallah. The mindset of the Muslim should be different. No, he should be looking at solutions. What can I do to better this Ummah? Yes, the Ummah is suffering, it's in pain. But am I doing my part in order to alleviate that suffering? What role am I taking? Am I being productive? You know, sitting down and complaining and pointing fingers, it doesn't help. And again, we have people that point the fingers at, you know, the shortages in the community. And we just, mashallah, filled with so much criticism, right? So much criticism. This guy's not doing enough, and this organization is not doing enough, and look, he's got no idea what he's speaking about. And what are you doing, akhi? What are you doing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This type of attitude is wrong. And we need to fix it. Because really, you know, there's a relationship between pessimism and failure. Just like there is between optimism and success. Right? When you enter a business thinking it's going to fail, then more likely than so, it's going to fail. When you enter a marriage and you're thinking, well, before you've even started the marriage, you think, what have I got myself into? Subhanallah. What trouble am I asking for? All right? You know, what am I getting into right now? When you enter a marriage with that thought process, wallahi, you're in trouble of the marriage failing straight away. Right? So we have to be careful in the way we approach things and the way we think. And you find this evident in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the way he spoke, in the way he dealt with things, even in the way he carried himself, the way he walked, the way he smiled. You know, the Sahaba would say, "Kana Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam dhahakan basama." Right? He would constantly smile. Whenever he would see me, he would smile. This was in Mecca and outside Mecca, during times of war and outside of the times of war. One of the companions would say, "The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam did not see me except that he would smile in my face." This was the attitude of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. You know, even when you visit someone who's sick, you know, someone who's sick, maybe that person's on their deathbed. You don't go to that sick person and say, "Wallah, I feel for your pain, you know, you're about to go through pain, I feel your agony. You know, death is around the corner, what can you do?" What do you say to someone who's sick? What did the Prophet ﷺ, what kind of dua did the Prophet ﷺ teach us to make? Who knows? That's the question I ask. When you go and visit someone who is sick, what kind of dua do you make? What do you say to him? Kafara, tahur, la ba'as, insha'Allah. Tahur. You tell him, maybe this sickness is a purification. It's something that's good for you. That's the way you're meant to look at it. It's something good for you. Don't think about, "Oh, I'm in pain, I'm suffering." Remind him, maybe that pain and suffering is actually good for you. Maybe it's an expiation for your sins. You know, once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he visited someone who was sick. And he told him that same, he told him, "Tahur, inshaAllah. May it be an expiation. May it be a purification for you. The man reacted, he said, you know, لا بل حمى تفور. What are you talking? You're talking about purification, my sins being forgiven. This fever I'm going through is agony, it's pain. It's going to lead to my death. You know what the Prophet ﷺ responded? He said, then so be it. Then that's what it will become for you. If you're going to treat it as such, if you're going to have that attitude and that outlook to such a trial and tribulation and hardship, then so be it, you will receive what you think. And this is where I draw you to, I draw your attention to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which is a hadith Qudsi, that Allah Ta'ala says, أَنَا عِنْدَ حُسْنَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي, that I will be there in accordance to what my slave thinks of me. If you think the best of Allah, Allah will be there for you. He will be the best for you. He will be your helper. And if you think the worst of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you may receive that. Then you may receive exactly that. Even when you sin, you're meant to have a positive outlook. So some may think, maybe that's an oxymoron. It goes against, it's contradiction. You're sinning and you still have a positive outlook. Yes. And that's what the Quran dictates. Alright? Allah Ta'ala, what's He say? He says, do not despair of the mercy of Allah. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Addressing whom? The sinners. And not only the sinners, the worst of sinners. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Allah addresses those who exceed their boundaries in sinning. Meaning they're the worst of sinners. Some of the commentators on this verse, they state that the ones being addressed were the worst of criminals. The worst of criminals. They had committed every sin on the face of the earth. Robbery, zina, rape, whatever you can imagine. Killing, murder. And Allah is addressing them. And He's telling them, don't disperse of the mercy of Allah. You still have hope. That's why for a Muslim to think, wallahi, there's no repentance, there's no mercy for me, is wrong. It is wrong. Again, the attitude of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Right? In Mecca, he was abused. Right? In Mecca, he was named so many names. Magician, sorcerer, you know, liar, poet. You know, you would expect that to make someone feel down, you know, make him feel down. But the Prophet ﷺ would find an excuse to think of it and turn it to a positive light. He would turn to his companions and he would say to them, أَلَا تَعْجَبُونَ مِنْ هَؤُلَاء. Aren't you amazed from the actions of these people? They're sitting there and they're cursing Muthammam. Right, whenever they would curse Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, they would curse him by the name Muthammam. Because Muhammad is a praiseworthy name. It comes from praise. So it doesn't make sense to curse and abuse someone whose name means praise. So they would change his name to Muthammam. You know, someone who's down. Someone who's low. And so the Prophet would say, aren't you shocked at these people? They're sitting there, they're cursing and abusing Muthammam, and my name is Muhammad. My name is Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam. That's the way the Prophet ﷺ would look at these type of occurrences. Again, one of the worst occurrences that the Prophet ﷺ experienced was Ta'if. Right, when Aisha told him what was the worst experience, the Prophet ﷺ said, Ta'if. Let us look at how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reacted to the event of Ta'if. You know, after he was abused and tortured in Mecca, and Mecca would not give him any assistance in delivering his message, he went to Ta'if in hope that they would give him help and assistance. And when he arrived in Ta'if, you know, the response was shocking. Not only was he abused and kicked out from Ta'if, but he was also kicked out with children following him and throwing stones at him. So much so that the soles on what the Prophet ﷺ was wearing was filled with blood. It was filled with blood. And the angel of the mountains came to him, alayhi salatu wasalam. And he said to him, what will you have me do with these people? Give me just the order. Just give me the order, the okay. And I will crush the two mountains on them. I will crush the two mountains on them. Now you can imagine the mindset of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. What kind of response a normal person would give. But what was the reaction of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? He said no. Maybe there will be from their children those who will come out and they will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those that will accept the message of Islam. Those that will accept the message of Islam. Before I finish, because I don't want to take too long, I do want to say that there is a distinction between optimism and delusion. Right? And that's why what I'm speaking about is balanced optimism. Not optimism that makes you lose sight of the facts and the reality on the ground. Right? I'm not speaking about that. You know, some people may misinterpret what I'm saying. You know, does that mean we turn the blind eye to what's going on around the world? Does that mean we turn a blind eye to the problems of our community? Absolutely not. Now what I'm saying is not that you see, you see thunderstorms and rain and the sky going crazy and you see, mashallah, today's going to be a sunny day. No. Or today is a sunny day. Such a person would not be considered optimistic. Right? Such a person would be considered delusional. Such a person will be considered delusional. That's not what I'm saying. I'm speaking about attitude and outlook. Again, very, very quickly, I don't have much time to expound on these, but it's very important to have a few tools that help us become optimistic. Right? It's easy to speak about optimism. And like I said, some people, wallahi, they're inclined towards pessimism. You know, I'll make a confession about me. I have a tendency sometimes to speak in negative tones. Right? To highlight the problems rather than the solution. That's a problem I have, but I'm conscious of my problem. Right? And I try to rectify that problem, and that's what's important. That we first and foremost understand that if we have a deficiency in our character, in certain qualities, that there's room for improvement and there's room for change. The first step is to first increase that relationship between you and Allah. Because a strong bond between you and Allah Ta'ala fosters optimism. The stronger reliance you have with Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, the stronger is your optimism and the better the outlook that you have. Right? So that comes by making constant dua, praying more, asking Allah Ta'ala more, and developing that relationship between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, optimism is contagious. And pessimism is also contagious. So we have to make sure that not only are we trying to become more positive in our outlook and our approach, but that we surround ourselves by people who have a positive approach and a positive attitude. Right? When you surround yourself around people who are positive, and remember this positive attitude also breeds becoming more productive. It makes a person more productive. When you're around optimistic people, you're around productive people, and that pushes you to become more productive. Right? If you're around people who are concerned about seeking knowledge, concerned about improving their iman, you know, and they're concerned about learning the Qur'an, teaching the Qur'an to their kids. They're concerned about becoming more active in the community to become an instrument of good. Right? You find yourself also becoming the same. And the opposite is true. Right? If you sit around commentators, you find yourself becoming a commentator. Those who are busy criticizing, you find yourself joining in. You know, if you can't beat them, join them. So you sit on the sidelines like the rest of them, and you become one who's just busy criticizing. So again, surround yourself around those who are optimistic or productive. Train yourself to smile. Well, it's simple. The Prophet ﷺ said, smiling in the face of your brother is sadaqah. Some of us, wallahi, a smile doesn't come naturally to us. Again, another confession. I used to get told in Medina, Ya akhi, why are you so gloomy? And I would say, well, I'm not gloomy, brother. It's just my face. It seems like I'm a bit upset, but I'm not upset. But again, that's a sign to me I should try more to smile. Maybe it doesn't come as naturally as it does to other people, but that means I just have to try harder. Smile. Speak good. Force yourself to only speak good. Right? Sometimes we get used to just speaking bad. You know, speaking in negative tones. Again, in negative tones. We have this problem, and we have that problem, and we have this problem, and there's so many sinners, and there's no hope, and this one is stopping me from doing good, and this organization is corrupt, and Ya akhi, you've left no hope for me, wallah. If that's the situation, let's just sit and wait for the Mahdi. And unfortunately, some people have that mentality, wallah. How many people have you met and they say, wallah, we just have to wait for the Mahdi to come and inshallah, he'll clean the corruption. Tayyib, akhi, until then, what do you do? Until then, what do you do? What's the solution? So you have to force yourself to speak good. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever believes in Allah in the last day, let him speak good or keep quiet. Let him speak good or keep quiet. And the Prophet ﷺ, when he was asked, what is tafa'ul? What's this optimism that you're speaking about? The Prophet ﷺ said, saying a good word. Al-kalima tayyiba. Saying a good word is part of optimism. It's part of having a positive attitude. Cleaning your heart from its diseases. This is a tool that fosters positive thinking. Right, to free your heart from jealousy and envy. Now there's a phrase that's said in Arabic, كُلُّ وِعَاءٍ بِمَا فِيهِ يَنْضَحُ. Right, in accordance to what a vessel contains, it gives forth. When your heart is filled with envy and jealousy, what do you find yourself speaking? Wallahi, this guy's got a car that he doesn't deserve. I deserve a better car than him. Look at this person who's got such a good job. I deserve a better job than him. Right? This is the type of words that come out of your mouth. Why? Because what comes out of your mouth is in accordance to what is in your heart. When you have a clean heart, right, you judge your brothers and sisters in a good way. Right? Those who are very judgmental, right, they're always looking at the faults of others. That's a problem in itself, right? Let me say that, it's a problem in itself. But it's actually a symptom of a bigger problem. Because it indicates a corruption in the heart. A corruption in the heart, and that's a serious problem. It indicates arrogance. Right? When Shaytan, he remarked, he refused to do sujood and he said, I am better than him. I am better than him. He was created from soil, I was created from fire. Right, that came, that type of speech, that type of attitude came from what? From his arrogance and his pride. Likewise, when you find Muslims, right, they've only got evil to spread and evil to talk about, gossip, slander, right, then understand that such a person has got real problems inside the heart. Real problems inside the heart. And that's why one of the best examples of the companions who had a clean heart is that companion whom the Prophet ﷺ said, يَدْخُلُ عَلَيْكُمْ رَجُلٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. That a man from the people of paradise will enter upon you today. A man walked in. The second day, the same thing. The third day, the same thing. And this is something all of you have heard. Abdullah ibn Amr, he was curious, what quality does this man have? So he accompanied him for 3 days. And he found nothing special in the person. Nothing special. He doesn't pray Qiyam al-Layl, that's out of the ordinary. He doesn't fast out of the ordinary. So he asked him, what's this special quality that you have? He said, by Allah, I don't sleep. The only thing I can think of is the fact that I don't sleep having any hatred or harboring any hatred in my heart towards my brothers and sisters in Islam. Had a pure heart. He had a pure heart. And this is something that we also need to develop. To look at the benefit of everything. Look at the good side. Don't concentrate on the bad side. You know, they say when you look at a cup, you can be a person who looks at the cup and he sees a cup that's half filled. Right? You could be a person who sees that the cup is half filled. Or you could be a person that sees that the cup is half empty. Depending on your attitude. Right? You lose a job, you can think it's the end of the world. Right? You can think, oh no. Or you can think, wallahi, maybe it's good for me. Maybe I lost the job because it's good for me. Right? Think of the good before you think of the bad. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ, he would say, مَنْ قَالَ هَلَكَ النَّاسِ فَهُوَ أَهْلَكُهُمْ. Right? Whoever has this type of negative attitude, and he says that all of the people are destroyed, all of the people are corrupt, then he is the most corrupt. That's one phrase of the hadith. فَهُوَ أَهْلَكُهُمْ. There's another phrase that says, فَهُوَ أَهْلَكَهُمْ. That he is from those who contributed to their lowly state. Right, to them being destroyed. Constantly saying, Allah, the ummah is destroyed, there's no khair in the ummah. He is a contribution to that state. He is a contribution to that state. So these are some of the tools that we can use to foster optimism and a positive attitude. And we'll end with this, inshaAllah. وجزاكم الله خير وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.